Japan's history does not revolve just around anime and nukes. And if anyone disagrees, you can answer to my blade. For real though, I don't know if anyone actually believes that, but I mean, the memes might confuse you a bit because that's all they focus on. And just like we did in the last video with France, I'd like to bring up other achievements they've had in history. That way we can maybe spread the love around. It's pretty obvious that there's a lot of people that have a lot of interest in this nation, and I think for good reason too, because they've been through a lot. I mean, the Japanese can kind of be summarized as they were mostly just kind of to themselves for a very long time, and then they tried to go for a domination victory. It didn't really work out. But I mean, it was a good attempt. Let's get their geography out of the way. Japan has a lot of islands. The main four are these ones, but they actually have 6,852 total. The tallest mountain is a massive volcano next to modern day Tokyo. This is called Mount Fuji. And Japan is kind of known for having frequent eruptions, earthquakes, and other natural disasters. Sometimes that does come in handy though. Not often, but in rare instances, man, they can kind of save your entire nation. The Japanese islands were pulled away from the Asian continent millions of years ago, so human beings weren't really here at first. People did begin to pop up around the end of the last ice age though, and they liked pot. That's safe to say, they liked a lot of pot. They were known for pressing these rope patterns into the clay, and actually, they're believed to be some of the oldest forms of pottery in human history. The first known reference to Japan was from China during the first century, and these two kind of had a love-hate relationship. Mostly hate, but yeah, it's mostly hate. But here's the thing, I mean, early on, the Chinese had a major influence over the Japanese people. Their writing system, religions, and form of government would all arrive on the islands around the same time, along with other things in the future that would be adopted. They had a big impact on this country. Now, obviously, Japan here was pretty divided early on, just between several different clans, but they would slowly unite under a single kingdom. So the Japanese emperor, he's kind of a big deal, you probably heard of him, he had some control over the country, but so did this powerful clan as well. The two would intermarry between each other, and this monarchy, the first and only of its kind in Japan, is thought to be the oldest in the world. This would even give us our little Hirohito-chan one day, as well as his son, the current emperor. Japan would go through a golden age for a few centuries, so things like poetry, literature, and religious life were at their height. It wasn't all good though, since a massive smallpox epidemic did kill like a huge portion of the population. It's believed that at least 25% of all the people on the islands died. So, I mean, that's bad, but the plague probably should have increased its infectivity rate. You gotta lie low for a little bit. That's how you win this game. Oh yeah, and a little group of elite warriors would also take power and rule Japan for about 7 centuries. They kind of had a lasting impact. Now imagine this. Okay, so you're Japan, and you just got this awesome new Pokemon named the Samurai. And you want to try them out. You heard they're pretty powerful. So you go and walk into some tall grass, you know, try to gain some XP. You wait to see which enemy pops up first, and oh no! It turns out it's a fucking level 100 Mongolian Empire. Pretty much the strongest thing on the map. And now, with no warm-up, and you just got this new Pokemon too, you gotta fight basically the Mongol Mewtwo of this world. You can't run either. Okay, you keep trying to run away, but it doesn't work. Now you probably start to think, like, man, we have the worst luck of all time, but that's actually not the case. Actually, the exact opposite. Okay, so when Korea lost their war and became a puppet, the Mongols began to attack from the peninsula. Then, Mongolia started out by winning 3 different battles on 3 separate islands. Things did not look good, and I think it's safe to say a Japanese empire conquered by this nation would have obviously changed the course of history. But remember that whole, like, natural disastrous thing I was telling you about? Yeah, that was about to come through and sink a whole ton of ships and pretty much stop the first invasion. So 7 years later, the Khan at the time was probably thinking, okay, wow, that was really unlucky. Let's go ahead and just try that again, because there's no way that could happen for a second time. What the fuck? Yeah, it happened for a second time. This place got incredibly lucky. I mean, don't get me wrong, the Japanese forces did prove their strength, and they did win a couple battles, but it's kind of difficult to imagine they would have won by themselves. I don't know if someone back then found, like, the Death Note and just wrote the Mongolian Empire in it. That would explain a lot though. And this is where the word kamikaze comes from. Kamikaze translates to divine wind because of these two typhoons that pretty much saved Japan. Now obviously that word's gonna take on a whole new meaning a little bit in the future, but I mean, at least you know the origin, right? So yeah, I mean, it's safe to say this was a pretty defining moment for the Japanese people. Unfortunately, things would take a totally different turn as the country would begin a period of civil war. This event was called the Age of Warring States. But not to be confused with that other one. So even though the samurai and the shogun had been ruling for a while and they were doing just fine, things changed when a couple powerful landowners and or lords became a little too strong. A big old fight broke out between the various teams and factions to control all of Japan. For 100 years, these islands were in constant war. Until this one dude showed up. He might be bald, he might not, still don't really know, but he'd be one of three men responsible for the unification. He was known for his military tactics, free trade, and encouraging a new period of art, surprisingly. He seemed like an interesting guy, until he had to commit seppuku. Yeah, he cut his stomach open. He didn't really have a choice, but like, I'm good. No, thank you. I'll do anything else. Like, send me to France. Get out the guillotine. I'd much rather take that. Keep in mind, Japan also invaded Korea around this time. Didn't go so well, but it's all good. I mean, they'd be back. The Civil War would finally end, but not before a few new faces popped up. And I'd imagine this was kind of embarrassing, right, for the Japanese to meet all these new people. First impressions clearly didn't go that well. I mean, your islands kind of were just total chaos. Portugal got there first, but it was actually the Netherlands that would end up being their bestie. They would be best friends for a very long time, ended up trading things like spices, sugar, and silk for books, scientific instruments, and other cool European stuff. This went on for a couple decades, but then there was this uprising with Japanese Christians. They were rebelling against the shogun in power at the time. This is how Japan found out the Dutch were their real homies, because they were the only Europeans to help stop this revolt. As a result, all other Western nations were kicked out, leaving the Netherlands as the only ones left. The next couple centuries would be a period of isolation for Japan, but their contact with the Dutch would end up being super important. They would learn about things like Western technologies and other medicines, but also, and this might be even more crucial for human development, they found out about coffee, beer, and chocolate. I mean, these are the things that really matter. The relationship between these two played a key role in the modernization of Japan, and that's gonna be a pretty big deal coming up here. However, being isolated was not the only defining thing of this period, because there was also strict social order. After fighting amongst themselves for so long, Japan did not want another civil war. Social classes were adopted to hopefully keep the peace, and for the most part, it worked. The economy boomed, and so did the arts. Some of Japan's most famous works were created during these years, including The Wave, which you've already seen multiple times in this video. This is actually an emoji now, so the Japanese peaked a long time ago. This period would be brought to an end, though, partly because of the US. They kind of forced the Japanese to end their isolationism, or else. This and other factors would ultimately lead to the end of the samurai and the beginning of an empire. Japan was like, hey guys, if we don't westernize, we gonna get our ass beat. Just something to think about. The goal was to combine modern advances with traditional Eastern values. The nation would also industrialize so fast, it was scary. Before anyone realized, the Japanese were a great power. Well, actually, some places were gonna learn that a little bit sooner than others. So we all know about the Japanese invading China during World War II, but that was the second time. The first conflict occurred several decades earlier. Japan was able to completely embarrass the Chinese and prove that their own attempt to modernize pretty much failed. It didn't go as well as they might have hoped. And not too long after that, it was time to slap Russia around. This was arguably a much bigger deal though. The Japanese had a landslide victory here that completely shocked the world. This was the first time in the modern age that an Asian power would defeat a European. Funny enough, both of these losing nations that took that big old fat L, they actually decided to just throw everything out and turn to that whole communism thing. I mean, obviously that would require a devastating civil war first, but maybe that's what happens to you when Japan defeats you. You turn to some German dude with a beard. The Empire of the Rising Sun would quickly take coastal territory from neighbors and the entire Korean Peninsula. They then joined the winning side during World War I, which got them even more land in the Pacific as well. As the country grew though, political and economic instability would definitely change some things on the inside. They would start to get even more aggressive. Japan lacked many resources on their main islands, and they were completely reliant on Western powers for things like iron, oil, coal, you know, all those things you need to win a war. This kind of forced them to be a little bit more ballsy than maybe they would have liked. You know, they had to take as much land as possible just to somehow sustain their empire. All these reasons and more caused them to invade China for a second time and join World War II on the Axis side. The Greater East Asian Co-Prosperity Sphere, that's a huge mouthful, was massive at its time and pretty terrifying. It didn't last, as we all know, because of America and, you know, the nukes, but just to confirm, I mean, they had taken a lot during their imperial days. Unfortunately, they couldn't do what they did in the past and pray that two storms kind of save them. They had to try this new kamikaze strategy, which was interesting to say the least, but yeah, it didn't win them the war. The Soviets also dogpiled in at the very end, which probably didn't make things much easier. That was Yeah, that was kind of the final nail in the coffin. And even though the nation had been devastated by the conflicts, Reconstruction would quickly bring them back. A few decades later, they were already the second largest economy. Now they're the third, but still. And they're so happy now they don't even want to have kids. So as you can see, their history includes a lot more than just the nukes and just the anime. That was a very small portion of this video. They've got plenty of other things. So just to review some of their achievements, they defeated Mongolia at their heights. With some help, they industrialized and became the first Asian power to defeat a European, and they were never colonized, which is a very small list of nations that can actually say that. Don't forget to watch the other three episodes with France, Italy, and Poland, and let me know who you'd like to see next. I'm thinking about doing a poll. I might do that. We'll see. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time. And big thanks to Furry Cruz, LBC, Destiny, 9000,
Paint Me Like You Do Your Sheila,
Elijah Senpai,
Crucifixion,
Swiss Argo,
Maxi G,
King Solomon,
Ben Moke,
Gally,
Tanner of the Nazareth,
Mr. Perkelly,
Cooter Donkey,
Brandon H,
Mega Fat Boy,
A Sneaky G,
Jared Clark,
thank you.